And in the DVD commentary, it is revealed that the director asked Marilyn Burns if she could squeal like a pig when depicting her moments of trauma. Most likely she couldn't, so what do we hear dubbed over the soundtrack as Sally is manhandled at the dinner table? Pig squeals. Leatherface is big and fat like a pig and wears a pink shirt, which is the colour of pig skin. He wears a mask of human skin, just as humans in the real world wear clothes made of animal skins. And there's a stitched tear in the forehead of his mask, perhaps caused by a sledgehammer execution of the victim, much like a cow. Interesting that his own brother calls him Leatherface, even though leather comes from the skin of animals, not humans.
Hey Leatherface! Give me a hand with Grandpa!
There are also animal hides in the house, particularly above the stairs. Hitch has a bag made out of some sort of animal hide and has been running around collecting dead animals all night. And all three family members have animal-like teeth, especially Leatherface, who licks his own teeth like an animal might do, and they howl like wolves at the dinner table. The presumably female corpse in the attic appears to have boar teeth, and I always wondered why Grandpa's skin appears to be so green and rubbery looking. At first I thought it was a mask, but perhaps the answer lies in this shot. We pan from the face of a chicken to Grandpa's face. Is he intended to have the wrinkly yellowish skin of a chicken? I don't know, maybe. Mixed in with all this animal versus human reverse slaughter symbolism is the notion of buyer complicity in the treatment of animals. Early in the story, the victims buy sausages and burgers from the old guy's store, which has a sign that says, "We Slaughter Barbecue."
I got some good barbecue here. Hey, I got us some barbecue.
Presumably at this point they're eating the flesh of other human victims, though they think they're eating animal flesh. This is significant behaviour because Franklin and Hitch have already talked in detail about the suffering of animals bred for meat, and yet here they are on the same day just an hour or two later, buying and eating what they think is animal flesh. Franklin also seems to make an exaggerated point of eating this sausage, which the filmmakers joke about in the DVD commentary as being a human penis, and which the actor has stated in interviews was actually a raw sausage. One of the many radio broadcasts heard throughout the story speaks of a couple who were killed and the man's genitals removed. Here's the clip, and I'm not sure if you'll be able to hear it with your volume there. You may have to get the DVD and have a proper listen for yourself with the volume turned way up.
Have been unable to identify the bodies of a young man and woman discovered by children in gymnasium. Given the stab wounds and their features carved away, the man's genitals had been removed, and police first identified the victims as two women.
Now, I'm not a raging animal rights activist myself, as I'm generally more concerned with other social issues like education and democracy. But I don't mind saying that as buyers and consumers of meat, we do support and fund the treatment of animals the Texas Chainsaw Massacre is protesting against. It's an unpleasant truth. According to Forrest Whitaker of Slate magazine, director Toby Hooper stated, quote, "I gave up meat while making that film. In a way, I thought the heart of the film was about meat. It's about the chain of life and killing sentient beings, and it has cannibalism in it. Although you have to come to that conclusion by yourself because it's only implied." End quote. But Chainsaw isn't just about animal cruelty in the meat industry. I've already mentioned the references to the slaughtering of animals to make clothing and leather-based products. But there are suggestions of other forms of cruelty. We kill animals and stuff them as souvenirs, two of which are seen on the arms of Grandma's chair, and there's a weird pig or dog skeleton wearing some sort of fur hide. There's the selection of animal skulls and heads on display, just as real-life hunters put the heads of animals on their walls. And Hitch has a bracelet with animal bones on it. And there's the weird moment of the old guy beating Sally with a broom, a strange choice of weapon, just as humans sometimes beat their pets or kill rats and mice with a broom. He then ties her limbs like livestock to the slaughter and stuffs her in a bag, just like Hitch, who was collecting dead rodents in a bag. And I always thought it odd that the old guy has teeth that make him look somewhat like a rodent. Even the basic phenomena of animals being killed accidentally on roads and highways appears to play its part in the film. We get an opening shot of a dead armadillo on a road, very carefully framed so that we see the main character's van drive across the top portion of the screen in a way that looks like the armadillo is being symbolically run over. A dead armadillo is also later found in the most bizarre place, on the dinner table. And perhaps Hitch being run over by a cattle truck at the end is a symbolic reversal of animals being killed by humans in the same way. And at the beginning of the film, I'm not sure what kind of truck this is that splashes dirt in Kirk's face and sends Franklin rolling down the hill. It might be a livestock vehicle, but either way this particular event in the story is really odd. Franklin's role in the story is especially important because he seems to be a sort of crossover between regular people and the psychos. He talks enthusiastically about the death and suffering in the slaughterhouses in a way that isn't really much different to what Hitch has to say on the same subject.
They'd have to come up and bash him 2 or 3 times, and then sometimes it wouldn't kill him. I mean, they'd skin him sometimes even before they were even dead.
Oh, that's horrible. Yeah. People shouldn't kill animals for food.
Well, they don't do it like that anymore. Now they got this big air gun that shoots a bolt into their skull and then retracts it. It's just boom, goes boom, and then
Franklin, I like me. Please change the subject.
That gun's no good.
I was in there once with my uncle.
No way. With a sledge. See, that was better. They died better that way.
He expresses admiration for Hitch's self-mutilation.
It takes something, though. I mean, just to do that to yourself like he did. God.
Like Hitch, he carries a knife, which he picks at himself with, though not clearly as sadistically as Hitch does. And he starts vandalizing the van with it.
Franklin, you maniac, tearing up the van.
I just start doing that.
What?
Franklin, you're crazier than he was.
Like Hitch, his family has a history of working in the meat industry. And when Hitch got in the van, one of the girls joked that he should sit by Franklin.
What does he look like?
Well, the son of a bitch is going to smell just like the slaughterhouse.
Oh, give the guy a break. He can sit by Franklin.
Again, the two characters are being compared as kindred. Both characters blow raspberries.
Come on, Franklin. It's going to be a fun trip.
And doesn't it seem like a great big fat coincidence that the former home of Franklin's animal slaughtering family is within walking distance of the Psycho family's house? After all, the Psycho family do appear to basically represent the meat industry itself. Even the moments of emotional and physical sadism aren't as far removed from the real-world meat industry as we might hope to believe. Here's some footage of real-world slaughterhouse employees tormenting and torturing animals for their own entertainment.
Those who live to reach market weight are thrown into transport crates and loaded onto trucks bound for slaughter plants. Handling is often violent and frequently causes bruises, broken bones, and other injuries. But calves on dairy farms are dragged away from their mothers and violently killed, all so that humans can have the milk instead. Another routine practice is dehorning, burning into the calves' skulls to remove their budding horns. Painkillers are rarely used. A 2010 undercover investigation at a dairy farm in Ohio revealed a farm worker stabbing cows with pitchforks, beating them in the head with crowbars, and punching baby calves. An undercover investigation at a slaughterhouse in California revealed downed dairy cows being kicked, shocked, pushed with forklifts, and water hosed in the mouth and nostrils in an effort to get them to the kill floor.
This guy has decided that it's time to electrocute a pig's genitals. And there are examples of the supposedly humane airgun method of execution, which Franklin talks about, either being used as torture or simply being ineffective. And Franklin's story of animals being skinned alive when they aren't even dead yet is unfortunately true sometimes as well. You see, the issue isn't just about US slaughterhouses, which are bad enough. There are even more sadistic forms of animal treatment used in other countries where the laws against slaughterhouse cruelty are even more lacking. Take halal meat, for example, in which animals are killed very painfully and slowly by having their throats cut and their blood drained out of the wound, all for the sake of archaic religious ritual. And any idiots out there who think I'm disrespecting Islam or other cultures by criticising that barbaric practice can just get lost. You see, I don't buy into political correctness, I prefer genuine morality. So there you have it, that's my roundup of the meat industry and animal cruelty themes in A Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Now this video only covers one chapter from my full 11 chapter analysis of the film, which you can read on my website at collativelearning.com. The link is in the video description below. And if you're interested in film analysis of other classic horror movies like Hellraiser, The Shining, The Thing, Alien, The Exorcist and so on, then you can order some of my digital downloads, which you can get within about 15 or 20 minutes of ordering. Thanks for watching, I'm Rob Ager, don't forget to subscribe, until next time, adios!